All righty, gentlemen. It's good to see you all. I want to say thanks in advance for your attention to this assembly, to this reflection. We have two alums from the class of 2013. Erich Prince and Henri Mattila are here. These guys have founded a magazine, Merion West. I'm going to read some of their info from their About Me page. This publication was founded in 2016 to bring a new and independent voice to the current media environment, which has become too partisan and polarizing. As such, Merion West is nonpartisan and publishes critical commentary and in-depth interviews from across the political spectrum. Conservative, progressive, and independent viewpoints are published alongside each other on one platform, a quality that makes Merion West unique among its peers in media. Although their individual backgrounds may differ, our contributors are all similarly committed to delivering thought-provoking insights and analysis to their readers. So these guys are going to talk about a little bit what they do, why they do it, and please give them your attention. There might be some time for questions at the end, so if you have a question or two, please ask it at the end. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Kalate, and it is a privilege to get to speak to you all here today. I remember the last time when I was here on the stage. It was 2012, and I was giving a speech to run for Forum 6 president. Evidently, my speech wasn't very good, because that speech was the last one I ever gave at Haverford. So, Mr. Pfeiffer, Mr. Kalate, I appreciate the opportunity to try again. So, a couple of weeks ago, I went to Wyoming to celebrate Thanksgiving with my fiancé's family. We spent hours cooking dinner, watched movies, told jokes and stories, and of course, ate a lot of food. And true to tradition, on Thanksgiving Day, I let everyone know how grateful I felt. However, on that same day, I read a message in a group chat in which a friend said that today, you shouldn't be wishing anybody a happy Thanksgiving, but instead, you should treat this as a day to express your guilt for living on stolen land. I had never heard of that tradition before. But his remark reminded me of something I had read recently. A study from Harvard found that societal issues are one of the main contributing factors to more than 50% of young people going through an extended period of feeling down, depressed, or hopeless, which I find to be a stark contrast from what I thought was the true spirit of Thanksgiving. Like the pilgrims who came to these lands 400 years ago, and there's an illustration there. Thanksgiving to me has always been a day to take a step back and be grateful. But for some, it now means something else. Our magazine, Merion West, launched a project called Why America. In the article series, immigrants are invited to explore what America means to them. As an immigrant myself, I had always felt that many Americans don't have enough perspective on the country where they live, not because of willful ignorance, but due to the mere fact that they've lived here their whole lives. It's like a goldfish who doesn't know he's in water. Today, I invite you to take a step back with me as I explore what America means. I will give you some historical context on where the American Project lines up in the human story, and then I will speak to the values that I believe make America unique and why one of these values, which is freedom of expression, is the one we should be most thankful for. So, let's start with the backstory, and we're going really way back here. For virtually all of history, people have lived in tribes or kingdoms of one kind or another, almost always united by common ethnicity and language. These different groups would go on to fight each other over territory and resources, whether it was in brief battles or decades-long wars. If you were alive back then, you'd be just one bad harvest or a couple poor hunting trips away from complete starvation. In short, life was really difficult. As this chart illustrates, most people didn't make it to their 26th birthday. I'm 27, so odds are I wouldn't have survived back then. And In addition to life being just difficult, it was also brutal. Most societies engaged in unthinkable acts of cruelty, from human sacrifice in the places like the Mayan and Aztec empires, to public displays of torture for entertainment in places like Europe, to slavery, which was in one form or another practiced virtually everywhere. In practically every corner of the world where you found people, you would see some variation of the same kind of political organization. At the top of this pyramid you see here, you have a ruler, let's call him the king. He controlled the military and the religion. And then below the king was everyone else, common people like us. Whether it was the feudalism of Europe, the serfdom of Russia, the dynasties of China, or the pharaohs of North Africa, the basic premise was the same. There are a few people who rise to the top, usually because they want power by force, and then there's everyone else who live at the mercy of those with power. For thousands of years, with just a few exceptions, this political order remained constant, as reflected in the same low life expectancy century after century. However, there's some good news. Something started to happen in the turn of the 18th century. Thinkers like John Locke and Jean-Jacques Rousseau got together in Northern Europe and began to question the state of things. They asked questions like, does the king really have a right to force us to believe in his religion? Why does the king have absolute power over us? These were radical questions. So radical, in fact, it was like questioning whether the sun should really rise from the east and set in the west. We call these thinkers enlightenment thinkers today, and they concluded that the king slash the government should not have absolute power over the people. Instead, God has given every human being natural rights, like the right to speak your mind publicly, including the right to criticize those in power, which is a very revolutionary thought. Choose what religion you want to believe or not believe, and have the right to your own property without fear of those in power confiscating the fruits of your labor. Combined together, these ideas form classical liberalism, which is not to be confused with the word liberal as we use in today's politics. The word liberalism stems from the Latin root word libertas, which translates to freedom. So at its core, liberalism means that the default condition of a person is that they are free, with natural rights which those in power cannot take away. And the basic assumption is that if you have the right to live your life however you please, as long as you don't hurt somebody else or in turn violate their freedoms. In short, my right to extend my fist ends where your nose begins. While it may have been birthed in Europe, this philosophy didn't find a home there until much later. Some of you may recognize this painting. It was the founding of the United States in the late 18th century where these ideas were first put to practice. For the first time in history, a nation declared that all men are created equal under God. At their core, the first Americans shared a commitment to open debate, compromise, and a kind of agree to disagree mentality, which they openly practiced when they held the first impassioned debates that culminated in the signings of the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution. Most leading thinkers of the time assumed that the American experiment, because that's what it really was, it was an experiment, would be bound to fail. Practically everyone assumed that the experiment in open debates and elections would end in anarchy, and Americans would soon enough beg to be ruled by a king or a tyrant again, just to bring back order. Instead, what ended up happening was quite extraordinary. America doubled down on her principles. People of faiths were treated equally under the law. The federal government didn't make Christianity its official religion, even though most of its citizens were Christian. Disagreements were common, but they were dealt not with fists and guns, but in the newspapers and the ballot box. Commoners were granted the right to vote. Slavery eventually was made illegal, becoming one of the first countries in history to do so. Today, almost 250 years later, America is the longest standing democracy in the history of the world. Even in 2021, it remains a unique country because people are full members of society, not because of their belonging to a certain ethnic group, but because of their shared belief in this thing we call the American creed. There's no other country in the world where newcomers, let alone from a minority group, outperform the majority that has been there far longer. For example, the average Asian American household is richer than the average white household. This is also reflected in the Nigerian immigrants who come to this country for opportunity and attain the highest levels of education of any other group. Perhaps unsurprisingly, nearly half of the largest corporations in the country, they were founded by immigrants. Where I'm from, which is a small country in Northern Europe, in Finland, they point to this and say, wow, that is the American dream. And that is the magic of America. I think that this helps to explain why most major innovations, from something as simple as the light bulb, to the iPhone, to the internet, most major medical breakthroughs, like treatments for cancer, they all come from America. Of course, other countries have made great technological advances, and many countries enjoy similar freedoms to us today, like countries in Europe, South Korea, Taiwan, Japan, Australia, countries in Africa as well. But because America is the world's most powerful country economically and militarily, it has been able to defend these liberal systems when under threat. When communist forces invaded South Korea in the 1950s, America came to its defense. Today, South Korea is a vibrant, prosperous democracy, while their neighbors in North Korea live in poverty under a totalitarian government. If America hadn't provided Taiwan a guarantee of protection from mainland China, it's a practical certainty that Taiwan would not be the prosperous democracy it is today. Finland, the country of my own birth, would have fallen under Nazi rule in World War II or become a part of the impoverished, autocratic, and undemocratic Soviet Union if it wasn't for America's support of liberty in Europe during the Cold War. However, most nations around the world don't face an external threat. These countries, often referred to as the developing world, they have tried for decades to implement something that looks like a liberal political and economic order with a constitution, free speech, free elections, property rights. However, tribalism and corruption more often than not get in the way, which is what drives millions of people around the world from countries like Guatemala, Venezuela, Syria, and Bangladesh to liberal capitalist democracies like America. And you may guess America is still today by far the most popular destination for immigrants fleeing countries. These other countries struggle because the liberal order requires people to share a mutual commitment to each other's rights. Even if they belong to a different gender, religion, race, or just plain disagree with you. But this kind of tolerance doesn't come naturally. In fact, I argue history serves as evidence that this kind of system goes against human nature itself. Recently, we all bore witness to a painful reminder of this reality. After hundreds of thousands of lost lives, trillions of dollars of investments, and two decades of war, which is longer than I think most of you guys have been around, and certainly most of my life, it took Afghanistan only a matter of weeks to become a religious theocracy with no freedom of speech, freedom of religion, or practically any freedoms for women. And that happened once America exited that country. No, America was never perfect, and it's not so today. We all know that. But its continued embrace to live up to the ideals of the American creed have made it inch closer every generation. This has happened through public dialogue with the shared belief that just because somebody may think differently than you do, you can win them over by the power of your argument. Frederick Douglass's argument for ending slavery was that this vile institution violated the very principles on which America was founded. 100 years later, Martin Luther King Jr., he followed suit by reminding his fellow citizens that Jim Crow and the disenfranchisement of Black people went completely against the American creed. And most Americans agreed with him. But for some right now in this country, good faith debate is not enough. They say, it's my way or the highway. People who don't agree with them are either too dumb or too sinister to try to be debated. They're just too conservative, too socialist, too pick your own adjective. Most of our information ecosystem, from social media to cable news, online media, sadly operates with this assumption. Instead of providing a forum for open debate of the issues today, they engage in narrative building that appeals to one political faction or another, often painting the other side as irredeemable. In closing for my section, I want to tell you a story about my friend Kambiz. He was a journalist in Iran, and the stories he did were often very critical of the government there. One night when he's asleep at home, Kambiz wakes up to a pounding on his front door, and hours later, he finds himself sitting in a cold windowless cell, subject to repeated interrogations by the police. Yet, Kambiz continued to write what he believed to be true, and because of that, he continued to be subjected to the same cycle of imprisonment and interrogation. Alone in his jail cell, he would often wonder what it was like to live in a country where he could write without being afraid for himself or for his family. When Kambiz was eventually granted refuge to settle in America, he asked the immigration authorities to let him come before July 4th so that he could celebrate his first Independence Day on American soil. Now, for many years, Kambiz has been happy to continue his journalism career in America, including at our magazine. But he has started getting increasingly concerned about what he considers to be a growing climate of hostility toward the very idea of free speech and free expression. This hostility Kambiz has put his finger on is reflected in public polling data. A record number of Americans, especially young people, believe that freedom of expression should be restricted. However, it is our belief that freedom of speech and expression is the cornerstone of our liberal system. If we stop believing that good arguments aren't enough to make our case, then we are opening the door back to an unfree world, the kind our ancestors and immigrants to this country wanted to leave behind. And this is why we founded Merion West, which is our project dedicated to ensuring that there is a media outlet rooted in the classical liberal tradition of free expression and open, respectful dialogue that treats its readers, all Americans, worthy of debate. I now invite my co-founder, Erich, to come speak about the philosophy underpinning Merion West.
Thanks, Henry, and hi, everyone. My name is Erich. I'm the editor at Merion West. Thanks so much for your attention today and for having us here. So very happy to be talking to you today. So as Mr. Kalade mentioned, Henry and I started Merion West in August of 2016. And it was an audacious project, and there was a boldness, even arguably an arrogance, behind it. Here we were, two young guys in our early 20s with limited journalism experience, not that one can have altogether that much experience and much of anything at that age, but we believed that we could do things just a little bit better. Now, as you might imagine for me and Mr. Mattila over here, it took a while for things to get going. The news business, perhaps more than any other category of business, it relies on brand trust, which has accumulated over decades and in certain cases, centuries. But here we were hanging out the proverbial shingle amid the hyper-partisan acrimonious campaign season of 2016 and saying, we all know that journalism isn't working quite as it should. Let's try something new. It admittedly took a while, and I recall, for instance, that one member of Congress used to refer to me, and not affectionately, as the kid. Within a couple of years, however, we began to attract a loyal following, both in the United States and abroad. Certain things we did particularly resonated. One was the Why America series, which Henry drew attention to, and another in particular was our specialty of conducting long-form interviews with political figures, members of Congress, presidential candidates who didn't pan out, has-beens, and rising stars. These discussions, which sometimes ran hours long, focused on the issues rather than the sound bites or the ad hominem attacks. We didn't bait them, we pressed them. So Henri very poignantly described how he sees Merion West in terms of the broader project that is America. But I in turn want to talk about how Merion West and its guiding philosophy sits at the intersection of two seemingly contradictory ideas. They, when combined together, constitute respectable journalism or thinking more broadly, done correctly. These two ideas are one, intellectual humility, and two, the necessity of keeping one's head and not just automatically jumping onto whatever ideological bandwagon happens to be in vogue at a given moment in time. And upon closer examination, they are actually quite related. And when the first is practiced properly, one rarely finds himself falling victim to the second pitfall. So intellectual humility has been an interest of mine for a while now and featured prominently in a newspaper column, quote, "The Secret to Less Rancorous Political Discourse, Humility," end quote, that I wrote for the News and Observer just 1 month before Henri first approached me with the idea of starting Merion West. I didn't know it at the time, but the argument I laid out in that column would come to inform the entire editorial approach of the magazine, then still in utero. And this argument boiled down to the simple contention that our discourse is continually hampered by a failure to heed Wallace Stevens' admonition about the importance of becoming, quote, a lunatic, end quote, of one idea, while also acknowledging why this so often happens. In late November of last year, I published an essay at Merion West entitled "A Once Unnecessary Reminder, Criticism Produces Good Work," in which I discussed how a great number of recognizable and noteworthy works, from Chesterton's Orthodoxy to Millet's Christ in the House of His Parents, to more prosaically, Leonard Skinner's Sweet Home Alabama, came about as a result of critiquing or reacting against the works and of ideas advanced by other writers, thinkers, or artists. The beginning of the title, "A Once Unnecessary Reminder," was in reference to the reality that today it is increasingly fashionable to suggest that answers we widely considered wrong need not or even ought not be engaged with, something Henri touched on in his defense of free expression. Embracing intellectual humility helps us to avoid this manner of thinking. That process of engagement I alluded to is of vital importance not only to reach the correct answer, because also, as we know in practice, the process of engaging with answers later deemed incorrect is a very valuable exercise in its own right. That is the essence of why pluralism is so valuable and so part and parcel of our society, and why at Merion West we've become known for our steadfast commitment to representing a range of viewpoints, conveniently labeled, biases made clear and apparent, left, right, and center. Now, to be clear, this is not the same thing as saying there's no such thing as an objective truth. Rather, it's an acknowledgement of the reality that getting to said truth tends to be a lengthy and circuitous process. A degree of intellectual humility is nothing short of a prerequisite for sorting the truth from the rhetoric, reality from agenda-driven narratives. And before I carry on to my second point, I want to pause to note a procedural point about the above, the importance of being dispassionate in style. I know the investor Benjamin Graham used to say that enthusiasm in nearly every avenue of life is of benefit except in investing. But it's also true when it comes to advocating for and exploring the ideas. Along the lines of "I attack ideas and not people," the point is that one should refrain from investing himself too emotionally in a given argument. And this prevents one from being so taken with a particular worldview being true that he cannot revise his stance if it turns out upon closer examination that he'd been incorrect all along. To fail to do this is actually how we get into the current media climate, characterized by what I call the death spiral of partisan media, in which instead of a given outlet correcting past misreporting or misrepresentations, it doubles down, and in the process caters to an ever smaller consumer base who demands more and more of that same original idea, until, like a Russian nesting doll, there are only a few diehard remaining followers left at the end. Merion West, if it does nothing else, at least refrains from falling victim to this paradigm. But in today's media landscape, unfortunately, just being committed to doing that is no small victory. So moving on now to my second contention, it is put simply that you can't always just do what everyone else is doing. To be clear, this is not the same thing as endorsing being a contrarian for contrarianism's sake. And this is an opportunity to bring up a distinctly Haverford memory, in which a fellow student I once knew made me acutely aware of this pitfall. He was a brilliant, precocious young man at the time, and he actually introduced me to the subject of philosophy. for the first time when I was just a freshman, and didn't yet know there was actually an entire discipline dedicated to answering the sorts of questions that I was interested in, and previously had thought could only be ill-fitted into a history curriculum. But it became clear over time that he enjoyed the process of arguing, of winning arguments, of knowing how they worked more than getting to the destination. And he had so ardently assumed the role of the inveterate devil's advocate that he rarely paused long enough to reflect on the fact that, in fact, he believed in nothing. So it's important not to allow one's skepticism to extend so far as to obscure the axioms on which one's given worldview ought to be based, which is to say that having a skeptical disposition is not the same as being a contrarian. So with that disclaimer now lodged, how many times, though even in just the past few years, has the consensus fashionable view been wrong? I think of that famous quip from Wilfred Maclay, "We love to mock conventional wisdom so long as it's yesterday." But from early dogmas around the COVID-19 pandemic to Chicken Little panic prognostications of economic ruin forecast to follow in the results of certain elections to electoral prediction after electoral prediction turned on its head, we see time and again the most fashionable and automatically accepted viewpoints are so often wrong. I think sometimes of Charles Krauthammer. In an interview not long before his death, he was presented with the charge, quote, "The position you're defending stands in contradiction to 99% of experts in the field," end quote. To this, Krauthammer, one of the great journalistic stylists of the past half century, by the way, I might add, replied, "Consensus doesn't impress me. Prior to Einstein, 99% of physicists would have said Newtonian mechanics is sufficient to explain all the motion in the universe," end quote. But then again, there's always safety in numbers. From certain phase to ideological projects, the very fact that so many others not along in agreement subtly says to one, it must be right, it must be true. And then it's all the harder to be the first or even the second to say, hey, wait a minute. Similarly, when I was in college, Steve Schwartzman, the famous financier, came to speak to a group of about a dozen of us at Davenport College, Yale, the residential college where he many years before had also lived as an undergraduate. As the students looked at him after he finished speaking, greed barely contained in their eyes. And the question and answer session began. One student asked Schwartzman, who was then one of the world's richest men, what advice he had for someone in his early 20s looking to emulate his success. The kids were looking for something concrete, I'm sure. Take that internship at Credit Suisse or switch your major to computer science. But instead, Schwartzman said two things. First, and most importantly, don't marry the wrong person. And secondly, go to the booklet printed each year by Harvard Business School that lists the industries where the newly minted MBA graduates are heading, and enter anything other than those top three. If everyone is already onto it, it's too late. The kids looked at him in silence. They didn't know what to say. Media, fittingly enough, is one of those sectors that must be now in just about last place for bottom-line-focused Baker scholars and MBA graduates. But as the one friend of mine who knows the media industry best, Pedro Robinson, always maintains, that's where the opportunity is and always will be, in running into the fire. Now, there are in any given year a number of trendy, shiny new media projects, many of which are rebranded efforts financed by the legacy brands, that spring up, have their proverbial moment in the sun, and then either fizzle out or are captured by the same incentives that first took much of the news media astray. They then become the very things they once condemned. And they, like many of the individual journalists, writers, and editors who comprise them, simply can't resist doing what they do best, following the herd, not thinking for themselves, or worse yet, knowing they're wrong, but being too afraid to say so or correct course. So with that in mind, I'll close with an anecdote, and it applies to the news industry, what we dutifully refer to as the press, and it applies just the same to our lives in general. This anecdote comes from the 1992 French-Canadian film Leolo. In the film, there are two brothers, and the older brother, Ferdinand, is a scrawny young kid. He gets cornered one day in an alleyway by a group of bullies. They beat him savagely. Afterwards, a humiliated Ferdinand goes home, and he vows never again. He dedicates himself to bodybuilding, and in time becomes known as one of the strongest men in Montreal. He's shown in the movie performing push-ups on the dockside with people sitting on his back, and his arms become so large that he can barely scratch his nose. Then one day, the day he's been waiting for, he stumbles on that same group of bullies, this time in a different alley. Although they're initially impressed by his transformation, his astoundingly large muscles, what do? They go ahead and beat him again, senseless, like it was yesterday, and he barely even puts up a fight. That's to say that in media, in anything really, slapping on the varnish only goes so far. And unless you get the foundation right, it's just a matter of time before it all melts away. So thank you for your time today and for listening to Haverford graduates like us. I always think fondly of my time here and I'm grateful for the instruction I received, particularly in the English department. And sometimes more than my work at the index or high-minded literary discussions, one thing that was successfully drilled into me here was the fine print of the grammar rules and style guidelines, something one really can't live without when in the business of running a magazine. Thank you.
I want to thank those guys. We also have time for some questions. So any questions, if you have a question, you're going to need to either say it in the mic or say it aloud and I can say it in the microphone. Yeah, stand up. Go ahead. Go. Oh, all right. If you do have a question, feel free to line up at the mic.
How do you think corporate interests have influenced the legacy media companies? And what do you think about that?
Well, I guess media is, you know, it's always a business, and I would say it probably ought to be a business because the alternatives, right, state-sponsored media, obviously not good at all. I remember my usually very even-handed professors in college, you know, they usually didn't want to come down on any particular position. But it was only one time somebody said, you know, with all these, the media landscape, the real solution is we need to get, you know, government involved in media. It was the only time that my normally really hands-off professors were just like, no, that is absolutely not. And of course, that's the case. And we see that some of the nonprofit media companies that are, you know, whether it's The Intercept or, you know, a lot of the media companies, The Atlantic, they really operate as nonprofits now. You know, they're financed by really benefactor model. So I would say that I don't think that making money is at odds with good journalism. I think it's probably the best answer for all the ones that exist, because we're actually, right now is a great experiment time, you know, kind of laboratories of democracy or whatever. We have laboratories of how media companies are operating. And I would say the vast majority of them are really falling victim to the same thing. So what's the alternative to kind of ads? You say, okay, let's do subscriptions. But then when you do subscriptions, you have to cater to what your subscribers want. So if your subscribers don't want you to cover politician X because they really like that politician, or vice versa, you know, you're party to them. So I would actually argue conversely that the kind of historical ad-driven media is the best solution given all the other alternatives, because we can look at how they're functioning right now.
You talked a little bit earlier about like how you, when you were first setting it up, you had a bit of some people who would like call you the kid or like have some challenges. I guess like, were you ever like really discouraged by that and like thought about how, like, did that ever discourage you, or did you guys just always think you'd be able to get this off the ground?
Maybe Henry should answer this, because he's always a little bit more of an optimist than I am.
Well, I was never called a kid, but that's a good question. I mean, it was weird. We were 21 years old emailing congressmen and senators to, hey, can you come interview for us? And I don't know if you've ever heard the phrase, fake it till you make it. There's some truth to it. So we had, you know, we made our website look pretty professional. And, you know, these congressmen or senators, they must have thought that we're a way bigger operation than we actually were. You know, we didn't have pictures of us on the website for that reason, because it's just two college kids. So it's, you know, you have to try to, you know, do your best to, don't be afraid to go out there and, you know, old people and people who have, you know, like a lot of authority, they often respect young people too.
Yeah, I just want to add one thing, because we're talking about, you know, getting interviews. And actually, as I was telling Mr. Claudia, we're trying to get with the times a little bit. So I've started getting to podcasts a little bit. I had a podcast out yesterday, which talks about this idea of access journalism, which is a major issue. So you're saying, you know, going about getting interviews. And that's something also to consider is, you know, the politicians generally want to do interviews with people who are going to treat them favorably. You know, Mitch McConnell says in his memoir, I only talk to the press when it's to my benefit. But that's kind of how they all operate. So yeah, so a lot of it is, you know, you have to, it's kind of an unfortunate little trade-off where, you know, you're getting access is based on some sort of expectation that you're going to get favorable coverage. So if you start having negative coverage, which, you know, maybe the times demand it, it could be more difficult to get the interviews, to get that contact, no matter who you are, no matter what you're doing. So, you know, your phone, you know, you stop getting called back very quickly. I'm actually working on a story right now, and I'm not going to say who, but I'm being stonewalled very badly because it's on a district attorney. And I started talking to some police and they're telling me a different story. And, you know, they will not all of a sudden, after months of groundwork with their team, it's don't talk to Erich Prince. So that's also another dimension as well.
Last question, Erich. How big in building a following for your media company is social media? And if it is sort of a crucial aspect to it, how hard has it been with a lot of social media bringing in third-party fact-checking organizations and basically silencing sources that aren't deemed authoritative, which often tend to be those legacy media companies?
Okay, well, that's a really good question because that's at the heart of 98% of the trouble we have. Our distribution was mostly historically done. So basically two companies control the internet, Facebook and Google. So no matter who you are, you basically have to do a deal with the devil with one of them. I was actually on a phone call with someone at the Wall Street Journal the other day, and I was complaining about, you know, how, you know, I said, you guys are big enough where you don't have to worry so much about, you know, Google and Facebook putting their thumb on the scale. And he said, what are you talking about? You know, that's, we're affected by that too. So yeah, it's sometimes fact-checking, but sometimes even more arbitrary than that, unfortunately. So our deal with the devil is with Google, and Google used to drive us oodles of traffic until one day it didn't, literally overnight, May 1st, 2020. So, you know, the big tech companies control the flow of information on the internet. And it's not only the legacy sources, you know, Twitter went to war with the New York Post, you know, it's really arbitrary. And that's why actually we one of our contributors, Mike Mathis, who is a former, well, they start an organization called FAFI, First and 14th Institute. Henri doesn't love the acronym, but they're former Facebook and Google guys that are trying to figure out how to make the process transparent. So to the degree to which Facebook and Google do this, and people like us would argue they shouldn't do it for a number of reasons, for ideologically free expression, but more practically, they choose winners and losers based on, we don't know why. He's saying we need to make it clear how they operate. So they need to publish or make transparent how their enforcement actions work. And recently, we're weary of government getting involved, period, probably in that. We're concerned it might make things worse. But he's currently, he's currently working on a model that he's trying to emulate after FINRA to try to say, let's have a self-regulatory body that tries to do it. But yeah, we're kind of really on the front lines of what you're talking about, of the big tech companies putting their thumb on the scale. So it's a great question. Thank you so much. That's kind of the heart of it's the heart of most of our issues. Thank you.
Thanks again to these guys. I thought that was great. That was really interesting. If you have any other questions, they'll stick around for a few minutes. Feel free to come up before you head to class.